I love shopping at Trader Joe's, and it's not because of the low prices, Hawaiian shirt-clad employees, or heavenly ice cream sandwiches. I like Trader Joe's because of how few items they have. While normal grocery stores trade on abundance, Trader Joe's stocks the shelves almost as minimally as possible. So let's say you're at a Safeway shopping for mustard. They'll probably have at least 20 mustards of different brands, varieties, and price points. In order to buy mustard, you now need to answer a lot of questions. How spicy should a mustard be? What size of mustard do I need? What's the ideal shade of yellow for a mustard? Do you deserve an expensive mustard, or are you only worth the cheapest store brand? At Trader Joe's, there's no laundry list of choices, just mustard. How can you be dissatisfied with your choice when you didn't really choose at all? It's logical to think that more options would only allow people to get exactly what they want, but it rarely works this way. It's an effect you've probably heard of before, coined by psychologist Barry Schwartz as the paradox of choice. Schwartz says that, quote, when you give people too many options, they get paralyzed instead of liberated, unquote. Now more on topic, let's think about the way Main Street USA at the Magic Kingdom is visually designed. Imagineers often employ the use of visual magnets, termed weenies by Walt Disney, after the way his dog followed him around when he held a hot dog, as a way of building controllable and predictable patterns of guest flow. Think of the way the castle stands out alone at the end of Main Street, subconsciously tempting guests entering the park to flow directly towards it. Imagine how much more confusing navigating the entrance would be if Big Thunder and Space Mountain were just as prominently displayed on the skyline. The direction you need to head to enter the park suddenly becomes a lot less clear. Hopefully you're starting to see that these two ideas aren't so different. Is Main Street USA designed more like Trader Joe's or Safeway? Basically, when you're designing a theme space or attraction for visual clarity and purpose, less is more. This idea is shown all over Disney parks, but it's used to great effect in one of their most underrated attractions of all time, that uses subtle hints and techniques to cut through the visual noise and subconsciously guide your eyes to exactly what you're supposed to see. My name is Greg Gerberic, and this is the Queue Line Lectures, a series about theme park design. Before we get to that underrated attraction though, I think we need to look at the ride that most inspired it, the 1960s classic, It's a Small World. Many people have a strong appreciation for that ride, myself included, but talk to enough people and you'll hear some negative grumblings about it. You'll hear people say it's annoying, too long, or even just plain boring. But I think that the core of those complaints is the idea of repetition. Basically, every scene in the ride can just seamlessly blend into the next. And if you were to attempt to graph the emotional progression of the ride, you'd end up with a perfectly flat line. I think this homogeneity was likely intentional, as it feeds into the thesis of the ride that there should be unity around the world, and that only surface-level cultural differences, like language and clothing, separate us. But repetition is an inevitable byproduct of trying to create something that feels purposely samey. The most obvious example of this is the title song, which loops over 15 times during your ride. But I want to focus on the visuals. While the number of animatronic figures in the ride is still impressive, the scenes are almost identical in size and scale. It's hard to be wowed by an animatronic dancing child when you've seen about 200 more of them in the previous scenes, and since the ride is dedicated to presenting most of the regions equally, no one room is much larger or more spectacular than the last. In this way, the ride sacrifices having fewer big standout moments in favor of hundreds of smaller vignettes. I think this is where we start to see that paradox of choice kick in. With so many visual details, are you liberated or paralyzed? Let's quickly look at one of the first scenes of the ride that covers multiple European countries. In the span of about 30 seconds, the ride shows us hot air balloons, the London Bridge, characters sitting and flying across the moon, windmills, a rotating chess piece alongside Alice and the White Rabbit, a beefeater guard, a whole row of can-can dancers, the Eiffel Tower, a Spanish guitarist, a marionette puppet, and even more in the background I don't have time to describe. The amount of visual overload here was no doubt intended to overwhelm the riders, and that way I think it's successful. The ride can be pulled in so many conflicting directions it can be difficult to absorb much of anything. Take a second and just watch this scene. Now how many elements of it can you recall? Did you even see the woman playing the flute? How about the kids playing the drums? Or the ones riding the elephant tusks? How about the frogs, the hyenas, the giraffes? I could go on, but I think you get the point. This is the Safeway approach writ large, and with so many places fighting for your focus, I think it all just ends up blurring together into a mess of color and sound. What fine details does your eyes pick out in a scene like this one? Or this? I don't think this approach is inherently wrong, and guests have found much to love in this ride for over 50 years. But how can we evolve the concept? Is it possible to make a ride with tons of animatronic figures, varied locations, tons of music and actions, and still make the small moments stand out? Well, that's what I think Sinbad's Storybook Voyage at DisneySea pulls off perfectly. The ride begins modestly enough with an entrance that's tucked into the corner of the Arabian Coast area of the park. While the facade is made to look like a giant fortress, it blends into the Moorish styling of the perimeter wall of the land, so it's easy enough to completely walk by without realizing it leads to an enormous attraction. Personally, I think this is really cool, as it doesn't overly tip its hand to what scale of ride you should expect, and makes the size of the experience an even more pleasant surprise. But practically, this low-key curb appeal was probably a mistake, as the ride's consistently low wait times is a decent sign many guests at DisneySea miss this attraction completely. These low wait times are great though, because the queue isn't much to write home about. It's just a short path through the interior of the fortress, though the walls are decorated with images that basically show what the literal pages of a Sinbad storybook might look like. It helps set the tone of childish and lighthearted adventure, while also introducing some of the characters and settings we'll see on our journey. Setting sail on our boats, we see a town on our right, and the song for the ride, Compass of Your Heart, begins winding up. While this scene mostly establishes setting, it's elevated by a few small touches. First, as we fall slightly into the flume, I like the way our ripples cause the other dock boats to actually bob up and down, establishing the physicality of the ride system, and the idea of actually being out on the open waters, sailing with Sinbad. Secondly, we get our first subtle instance of the ride gently guiding our eyeline. Watching the background, a flock of birds moves quickly from right to left, and our eyes naturally follow the motion as we're guided towards the arch into the first show scene. This is where we really begin to see the full clarity of the ride's visual design in full force. This scene shows a bustling town and market that serves as Sinbad's port before setting off for adventure, and while we get a huge sense of scale and activity, I'll trace the way it cuts through that potential chaos. The archway frames our look right at Sinbad and his pet tiger Chandu. The pair are also brightly lit by a spotlight, which makes their presence as the protagonist of the ride more clear. As we exit the arch, we get a chance to look at the full scope of the market, and huge amount of characters here to get a sense of place, before Sinbad begins speaking directly to us, pulling our attention. When he's done speaking, his arm motion swings to the right, pushing our eyeline towards the sheep herders and their banner that reads Farewell Sinbad. We begin to hear flutes playing with the music from the boat's right side, and our eyeline swings over to the musical trio. There are background figures providing extra motion behind the musicians, but they aren't fully illuminated, so we pass the musicians and our attention moves back to the left, and we see traders haggling over a rug, until a flute solo kicks in, and we shift over to the dancer, swaying to the music. Back on the right, a chimp shakes a sign very close to our peripheral vision, and we look right at him. Just behind the chimp, we notice the light of the shadow puppet scene, and the sound of the man's string instrument enters the track. We see the backside of those puppets before the old man on the bridge begins speaking to us, and we look right up at them in their glowing crystal ball. This one scene demonstrates exactly how careful planning and timing can turn visual noise into a choreographed pattern that turns on a dime to drive our vision to either side of the boat. Despite being jammed with more than 50 animatronic figures, every lighting choice, music cue, and animatronic movement directs our focus. Each small vignette gets a chance to play out and make a concise impression before pushing our eyes elsewhere. Leaving the market behind, we head out to sea, and the large empty spaces of the room help conjure images of an endless ocean. Water splashes down on us as a storm rages on our left, but brightly lit in the distance is Sinbad, guiding our way. While the market had musicians playing along to the ride's music, this takes it a step further, having Sinbad singing the lead vocals, like this is a full musical. This choice to make the music diegetic, meaning it's coming from a source within the fiction and not just played over the scene like a soundtrack, helps map the progression of the song with our voyage. It gives Sinbad a fun, energetic context for every scene he's in, and it makes the soundtrack feel integral to the ride, rather than something that's just blaring over the loudspeakers. As we saw in the first scene as well, diegetic music can be a fantastic tool for guiding the focus of riders, as we instinctively look towards the source of the music we're hearing. We pass some mermaids and we're into the next scene, where our angle of entrance into the room restricts us from seeing anything but a pirate, chopping away at a giant egg. What's in an egg of that size? And what would have laid an egg that big? We'll see this pattern repeated throughout the ride, but all large figures are teased in some way before they enter full view, which helps build tension and anticipation. We turn right and we see a perfectly placed palm tree that works to obscure something large behind it. Again, our anticipation builds to see the giant figure in full view, but it isn't time for that yet. With our view blocked and Sinbad now singing again, our focus is on the scene in front of us, where Sinbad wrangles some pirates trying to capture the now hatching eggs. We finally pass the palm tree, and we have a clear view of the giant mother bird dangling a pirate right above our heads. While this is just 1 minute of ride, careful blocking and positioning of the scene allows for a full 3-act structure, of egg to hatchling to mama bird, that would be much less impactful if we instead just spent that whole minute staring at the giant animatronic and missed all the smaller scenes. From the large scale, we move into a tight cave which closes in on all sides and lowers the ceilings. This works as a palate cleanser of sorts, resetting our sense of scale so we're constantly impressed by each new huge element. The constant shrinking and expanding helps the ride feel dynamic and surprising, rather than the straight graph of It's a Small World. This is also our next example of teasing a huge figure, with the giant's face towering over Sinbad as he frees him with the magic feather from the mother bird. Angle of approach comes into play here again, blocking us from seeing anything in the next room other than the pirates, who are terrified and tied up. What are they terrified of, though? The music reaches a swelling chorus and we see the massive green giant, playing and singing along with Sinbad. The giant is such a visual magnet, the whole scene is clearly designed around giving you as much time as possible to appreciate his crazy scale, and putting the rider so close to him only makes him seem that much taller. His loud, booming voice dominates the music, and only once we get close to Sinbad do we hear him play a little solo on his strings that pulls our eyes away from the giant for just a second. Even Sinbad's Tiger Chandu is positioned right in front of the giant, a smart choice, as designers understood riders would still be looking at the giant for as long as possible. Just like how the scale likes to get smaller before large moments, this scene acts as a calm break before a very energetic moment. We enter a sultan's palace and notice the large elephant on our left, before all the main action of the scene jumps over to the right, with dialogue and singing by Sinbad and the sultan, as he gives Sinbad all of the instruments. As we pass by, Chandu makes sure we notice him by jumping on the drum in time with the song. From that relative calm, the ride really goes for full chaos for the first time. The music alone here is way more manic and percussive, and makes it more difficult to pick out the individual instruments, and since there's no lyrics from Sinbad, it doesn't really draw your focus to him. From a lighting and placement perspective, the ride really breaks its visual continuity by putting these two monkeys almost equally on both sides of the ride. Rather than directing us to look at one thing and then another, we're purposely overwhelmed here, surrounded by a tribe of musical monkeys. This continues as we turn the corner and the monkeys are placed high above us, dangling bananas close to our head, which works to invade our personal space, again, heightening that chaotic feeling. As we pass Chandu again, we get a strong smell of bananas, which has nothing to do with visual focus and design, but it's just a small detail I really love. We enter another cave which helps reset our sense of scale and tease something big coming, as we see a large shadowy creature pushing up Sinbad's boat on the horizon. What could that be? Well, it's a massive whale animatronic, of course, with Sinbad and Chandu on its back. Much like with the giant, the designers knew this scene was all about giving us as much time as possible to appreciate the whale, with nothing placed on the left side of the scene at all. You have nothing to do but marvel at the size and complexity of the figure, as it bobs up and down and the waves crash behind its flapping tail. After our long journey around the ocean, we catch a glimpse of the lighthouse keeper welcoming us back home before turning to take in the full breadth of the last scene. There aren't any music cues, lighting changes, or block characters to guide our line of sight, but there isn't supposed to be. This is certainly the scene that's most reminiscent of that It's a Small World visual smorgasbord, but here it's done with a different purpose. Like turning the last page on a storybook and returning to the cover, nothing in this scene is new. This isn't a strange island on Sinbad's journey, it's the town he embarked from way back in the first scene. On our right, the camels are carrying treasures collected by Sinbad along the way, like the gold from the giant's cave, the instruments given by the sultan, and the bananas from the monkey island. In the main village square, we see many of the old characters welcoming us back home, like the dancing woman, musical trio, and old man with the glowing crystal ball, alongside more treasures, like the feathers from the mama bird. Much like how It's a Small World uses an overabundance of props and characters as an attempt to summarize an entire country, this finale does the same to create a visual montage of our journey with Sinbad. We give him and Chandu a final curtain call before disembarking, right where we began. I won't argue it's an elegant metaphor, but I think it tracks that Sinbad's storybook voyage has more in common with the Trader Joe's than with Safeway. It avoids creating visual paralysis by using carefully choreographed diegetic music, lighting, and positioning to always be subconsciously cutting through the dense details layered into each scene and guiding your eyes to the next idea. So why have so few people heard of this attraction to begin with? Well, it's not a thrill ride, it isn't based on known Disney characters or stories, the outside of the ride does little to draw in guests, so, and of course, it's thousands of miles away from most US Disney fans. But if you're lucky enough to find yourself in Tokyo, don't make the mistake of walking right by Sinbad's Storybook Voyage without giving it a second thought. Go inside, sit down, sail with Sinbad and Chandu, and experience this masterclass in themed entertainment design. Thanks for watching.